What's up, guys? We participated in the CrazyGames web jam where the first place wins over $20,000.
The thing was, everything is a remix and we had 1 week to make the game. This was actually our first game jam ever, although we have been making games for almost 6 years now.
So we were really hyped and we had no idea what we were doing. Vampire Survivors roguelike type of games are fun to play and have a really high replayability. So we started brainstorming on how to remix these kind of games and came up with the idea to take random upgrades plus multiplayer, bones, arrows and horses. Because we had only 1 week to make the game and we never made a multiplayer game before, we decided to make a single player version first and add multiplayer later on. And let me tell you, this was a really bad idea. Turns out that adding multiplayer last is like building a house and trying to put the plumbing inside the walls. Luckily for us, we only invested one sleepless week into making our game. It was not that hard to throw the whole codebase away and start over again. Anyway, the first version was never supposed to be the final version ready to be published. So the game jam was only to select the top 10 projects, which then would have a few months until the final winner would be announced. So we did not win the jam, but our game got picked in the top 50. So we decided to keep working on the game and turn the game jam project into a real multiplayer game.
Once idea was clear, I started looking for reference to model the horse. I had GPT generate a side view of a horse, which I used as a base. I stylized it a bit, gave it longer legs, and now our horse is ready. For the character, we are actually reusing the stickman from our game No Pain No Gain, and if you haven't played yet, go and give it a try. To reduce vertex count and keep things optimized, I simplified the hands by removing the fingers because we will have a few of them running around, so now we have a fingerless stickman. I model an arrow and a bow. And for the string, I made a balloon shape where we simply modify the value within the shooting animation of our character. We will have more than one bow, so in order to reuse the animation, we simply change the parent of the string when a bow gets spawned. Our target platform is WebGL, so we constantly need to think about performance. That's why I create the environment using as few different meshes as possible, because Unity can batch objects that share the same mesh and material, which reduce draw calls. Especially if we mark our objects as static, we can benefit from static batching.
This gives us also the option to use occlusion culling, which basically means we cull occluded objects, meaning objects that are not visible to the camera, for example hidden behind others, won't be rendered at all. To make this work, we simply enable occlusion culling on the camera, select the objects to be culled, and the most important part is to actually bake the occlusion data.
We disabled the shadows of the drones because you don't really notice them anyway. For the bushes, we use fake shadows, just a circle with a bit of blue. They are cheaper and look decent. To make the arrows look better, we add a trail, and there are chest boxes that randomly spawn different buffs. Although the animation is not that complex, we just recycle it from another game. To make it more clear that the player got hit by an arrow with buff, we create a particle for each one.
Now when it comes to multiplayer, there are a bunch of ways to do it. You can host your own server, but if you want a low ping globally, you'd need servers in different regions, but those can get really expensive. Or you can also go with the host client setup, where one player acts as the server and others connect to them. That's actually what we tried first, and we wasted a few days messing around with Unity's netcode for game object. But here's the thing, if you're targeting a WebGL like we are, you're kind of screwed with that. Browsers usually throttle or pause background taps, so if someone just taps out, your host server might start lagging or stop entirely. And talking about browser games, let's be honest, people are probably playing while in school or pretending to work or something, so hosting on the player side is a really bad idea. That's the main reason why we decided to go with a deterministic framework called Quantum. In a classical multiplayer setup, you need to send positions and sync everything. For example, you can see the positions of the characters are synced, but the health, arrows and basically every state is not synced at all. With Quantum, every player runs the simulation locally and only sends inputs, like move left, shoot, which reduces bandwidth, the data we need to send, and hence should increase performance and connection speed. That sounds simple, but it comes with some challenges. Every calculation needs to give the exact same result on every device. That's what determinism means. Same input, same output. And yeah, that sounds kind of obvious, but let me give you a little example. If you use floats and calculate 0.1 plus 0.2, you don't get 0.3, you get 0.3004. That looks super weird at first, but it actually makes sense. Computers only understand ones and zeros, so they store decimals, normal numbers, in binary. And that tiny error, plus the butterfly effect, breaks determinism. You end up with the same input, but a different output. And by the way, because it fits so well here, this is also exactly why you should never check if a float is equal to a specific value. Always use an approximate check instead. And well, to solve this problem, Quantum uses fixed point numbers, which basically means we have numbers with fixed amount of digits. 0.1 becomes 0.100. If you now calculate this plus this, you get 0.3 and not this weird floating point error. But honestly, that's not even a challenge. Quantum is ECS based, which means entity component system. So if you're used to normal Unity where you have a game object, throw a script on it, hit play and stuff happens, forget that. With ECS you have entities which are similar to game objects, components which are just data that you assign to an entity, and systems which do all the logic for entities with certain components. And Unity is just a visual layer on top of Quantum. All the real logic happens inside Quantum.
Now you know how multiplayer games work, so
that's also the perfect time to talk about their sponsor, CrazyGames. Actually, we reached out to them to ask for sponsorship, so don't skip this part because we think there's something really great for you guys. CrazyGames is one of the biggest web game platforms out there.
They have over 40 million monthly users,
mostly from the US. It's super easy to upload your game and you can get millions of plays on your own games. Actually, we have some of our games published there and it's really nice because the games are in front of a massive audience without spending a cent on marketing and you actually can earn some money with your games. And now is the perfect time to check them out. They are hosting a crazy web multiplayer jam 2025 in partnership with Photon. The jam runs from April 25th to May 5th and it's all about building multiplayer games for the web. There's 10,000 euros in prizes, photo licenses worth thousands of euros. You even get publishing opportunities directly on CrazyGames. Even if you never made a multiplayer game before, this is the perfect opportunity to start because there will be dedicated support from CrazyGames and from Photon, an active Discord. You have no excuses to not try and make your first multiplayer game now. We'll drop the link in the description. It's completely free to join. We will participate in the jam and it would be really nice to see some of you guys there. And if you're just here to play games, also make sure to check out CrazyGames. They have some amazing games on the platform. Let's get back to our game.
Because it will be boring if everybody has the same character all the time, we give players the option to change the colors, and for that we simply swap materials. I also create different skins and each one gives the player different abilities. The idea is to let the player choose if they want to focus more on health, damage or other stats.
To make the skins work, we set the object as a children of the corresponding bones. So for example, when a player selects the helmet, we just spawn it as a child object of the head bone. And disabling object stops rendering and logic, but it still keeps memory, so we only spawn once we need the object. We use a scriptable object for each skin that stores the prefab, its position and rotation, and we have another scriptable object that maps all skins with their IDs. While playtesting, we noticed that the player could just spam the left mouse button, so we added a small cooldown to the shooting and also an energy bar that refills if the player is not shooting.
To let players interact with each other, we create some emojis or reactions. We split them into parts so their colors can match the player's selected color.
One really nice trick we use to boost performance is having the whole game, or rather physics, colliders, movement and related calculations in 2D and not in 3D.
We will have gems all around the map that players need to collect to gain XP and level up their character.
And for things like jumping, we then basically have our 2D collider, and actual mesh is a child object that just moves up and down. And to not have hundreds of updates running all the time, we basically have a central bounce manager that only bounces objects if they are in a visible distance of a player. Well, to be honest, I have no idea if this is even a big deal, but we made it. Initially, the game was a 3-minute round, last one survived. Mode, but after playing a little bit, we think that it's much better to let people respawn and keep the players in a kind of flow state.
And for that, we created the shader to show a temporary immunity effect and added a warning to make it clear when a player is respawning. We also spawn some random speedballs and shields on the map, and we want to destroy the shield when it gets hit. I made the destroyed version in Blender, so now we simply disable the original shield and enable the destroyed version.
To add more competition to the game and social features, we added a leaderboard. We basically created a SQL database, hosted a PHP script on a website to write and read, and in Unity we then get and send the data with a web request. Especially on web, users are really nervous and every second staring at the black screen increases the probability that users just rage close the game. So to reduce the start time, we used addressables, which basically just means instead of having everything loaded right away, we only have a super lightweight scene and then we load everything else in the background.
To reduce the build size, which is super important for web games, we use crunch compression for all our textures, but when you enable it, you need to make sure the texture dimensions are divisible by 4.
For example, if your texture is 2048 times 44, but the max size is set to 512, Unity resizes it to 512 times 511, and 511 is not divisible by 4, so crunch compression says no. If you look at this texture, you can see that if we turn on the crunch compression, the size reduces significantly. And actually, this is valid for every sprite in your project. So there were a bunch of sprites with this resize problem. That's why we created the script that just resizes every texture of our project. So although we publish our game on a platform where we probably will get a decent amount of users, we can't solely trust on initial traffic to see if our game got picked up or not. Because if you open up a multiplayer game without any players, look, close it and forget about it. That's why we also had to add some bots. Are they smart? No. Do they work? Kinda. We learned a lot while making the game, and although we did not win the game jam, we now have a fully working multiplayer game. If we see that people actually like and play the game, we will definitely keep working on it. We want to keep working on it. We have a bunch of ideas for other game modes. Let us know in the comments what you think about the game. Also, join our Discord. Check out the game on CrazyGames. And maybe if you're watching this, the game is also available for mobile. Links are in the description. Comment, subscribe. Ciao. Go play the game. Or don't. Bye.